She's a killer queen, gunpowder gelatine, dynamite with a laser beam, guaranteed to blow your mind. Ooh, recommended at the price, insatiable and appetite.
When you were frozen, they were put on the endangered species list. We tried to get some, but it would have taken months to clear up the red tape.
You know, I have one simple request, and that is to have sharks with frickin' laser beams attached to their heads.
There are several different kinds of ionization techniques when it comes to mass spectrometry. Yes, electrospray ionization is extremely popular, especially when you're looking at compounds in solution. EI is perfect for GCMS, for gas phase compounds. But what about solids? Or what about samples that we just want to do something else with? Now, there are many different types of ionizations. We could lump them together in a process called desorptive ionization techniques, and I'm going to cover some of them in here. So I mentioned in a previous video that the 2002 Nobel Prize in Chemistry was awarded for development of techniques to study large molecules like proteins. So half of the prize was awarded to these people here, John Fenn for electrospray, and Koichi Tanaka was awarded for the development of a technique called MALDI, matrix-assisted laser desorption ionization. Now, the MALDI technique that most of us are familiar with today was actually developed by these two people here, Hillenkamp and Karas, who didn't win a Nobel Prize. And okay, there's a whole story we could get into, but I won't get into that. I will discuss both of those techniques so we have a sense of how similar they are to one another. Okay, so here's our solid, and it's going to be coated onto some solid support as well. Now, the compound could be like a chunk of something, a solid piece, or it could also be compounds in solution where we just allowed the sample to evaporate, so we leave behind a solid residue, a crystal, for example. So all of our molecules in solid will probably be all bound to one another through these intermolecular forces. How are we going to break that apart? How are we going to essentially evaporate or vaporize the molecule? The easiest way to do that is to apply energy. So let's heat the surface up, and that should cause these compounds to go into the gas phase. Well, that would be true for small molecules, thermally stable compounds that evaporate easily. But what about big things? What about proteins that are kind of bound within solids like a steak? Could you heat up a steak and just imagine that thing evaporating and then suddenly releasing these free-floating proteins? Quite unlikely. In fact, if you're going to heat up a steak, you're just going to char it up and make this, you know, charcoal kind of stuff. So that means we've totally broken down the molecule. So there's the problem with trying to evaporate something. You've got the interplay between whether you're going to evaporate it or whether you're going to just decompose the molecule. We can use the Arrhenius equation to think about how this will occur at different temperatures. So if you were to plot the reaction rate as a function of temperature, now more specifically 1 over T, which means this side is the hot end and things get colder on that side. Well, you can see that there's two different slopes here. So there's a slope involving the rate of vaporization, so to evaporate the compound, as well as another one representing the decomposition. What we're seeing with this equation is that the hotter things are, the higher the reaction rate for both cases, but the rate of vaporization is exceeding the rate of decomposition. So what that basically means is that the compounds are evaporating before they have a chance to break down. So the summary of all of this is that if you can apply enough heat energy, or more specifically, heat something up really quickly, then you actually can vaporize it before it breaks down. Yeah, I guess hitting a steak with high heat has a lot of different advantages to it.
Because the actual cooking time is very, very short. Now the water is hot. You can see the holy smoke coming up. 2 tablespoons of vegetable oil, 1 and 2. And then you put the beef right in. Just like that. There's a special Stephen Buckley for you.
This was like one of my favorite shows growing up. And Canadian television on CBC, there's only at 2 stations at the time. But nonetheless, this was a great cooking show. You guys should check it out if you can. Walk with you. But back to the story with mass spectrometry. that's not going to be fast enough. So you can think about heating up a metal target as much as you want. It's just not going to transfer the heat as quickly as you want. What you would do instead, for example, is to apply our sample to a solid surface, but that surface is cool. And instead, we're going to have like an electrode where the electrode is heated. And then what you can do is just apply this sort of quick switch with the solenoid, and that hot stick will like hit the sample and instantly apply that heat transfer. So with a process like this, you can heat a sample up not to 5 million degrees, but a rate of change of temperature of like 5 million degrees per second. The contact time is like far less than a second, so it heats up quickly. The thing is, that's still not fast enough. Rather than focusing on trying to apply a solid material to heat our sample up, there's other ways to impart energy. So you can just think of this high energy beam, like whatever that might be, but a beam of energy hitting our sample, and that's going to cause the vaporization. So what is the beam made of? Well, actually, it can be made of anything. It can be light, it can be ions, atoms, or a beam of electrons, anything that carries that energy through. And in fact, every single one of those options has been used in mass spectrometry, and each of them has their own favorite acronym that goes with it. So fast atom bombardment, secondary ion mass spectrometry, but the one that we'll focus on in this video, it will be exclusively dealing with the light energy, the lasers. So we have matrix-assisted laser desorption ionization. Now let's talk first about how laser desorption would work. In other words, without the matrix. We have our sample here, it's deposited onto like a metal support, for example, and our laser beam hits the sample, but in doing so, a lot of the energy gets dissipated into the solid support. You can do direct laser desorption. The only thing is you can't really use it to apply to large molecules like proteins, because most of that energy gets absorbed into the surface, so it dissipates the heat and it slows down the rate of heating. So this is what Tanaka did. This is the Nobel Prize winning idea. And the idea here is that instead of coating our sample directly onto the metal target, it's coated onto these tiny metallic particles, these micron size metal beads, so ultra-fine metal powder. Now, why is that an advantage? Well, if the sample is going to be coated around the surface of each of these particles, and the particles themselves are dispersed, so what Tanaka did is he held this within a matrix of glycerol. It sort of keeps all the beads floating apart from one another. So when you shine a laser onto it, the laser will heat the particles up. It'll heat the metal. But because the metals are dispersed from one another, it sort of keeps the heat trapped within just one of the particles. So that keeps all of the energy down to the surface, and it applies the rate of heating to be much higher, which allows larger proteins to evaporate from our sample. So this spectra is the proof. Now, keep in mind, this is like a really old mass spectrum. It's from the 1980s. But you can see an intact protein. So I think this is carbonic anhydrase, a protein molecule with a mass, as you can see right here. And unlike electrospray, the charge state is much lower with MALDI. So you can see the singly charged and maybe the doubly charged ion as well. This is done on a TOF instrument, and by the way, it is a linear time of flight, which means that the resolution is quite low. But nonetheless, this proof allows us to see that we can ionize large proteins without actually breaking them down. Now, what about the other version of MALDI? So Hillenkamp and Karas did not use these metal powders, but they still use the advantage of trying to absorb that laser energy. Just without metal, it's going to use these organic chromophores. So the molecules you see over here are what we now call the matrix. And you can think of these compounds as surrounding each of the proteins. Actually, the way that you do it is you add like maybe a 10,000-fold excess of matrix compared to our protein, deposit that on a target, and then let the solvent evaporate to leave behind a crystal where the protein is just sort of loosely peppered within that matrix. So this drawing isn't to scale. The protein would be much bigger than that. But now if we take a laser and we shine that down onto our sample, because the matrix itself carries UV chromophores, it can rapidly absorb the excitation energy of the laser, causing a rapid explosion. The proteins just get caught in that wake, so the two just sort of push themselves out from there. The matrix also has some acidic functional groups to it, so they can easily transfer a proton onto our molecule, onto the protein. And as soon as that thing is ionized, if this plate already carries the charge, and that's a time of flight system, then, you know, the thing's going to fly off and go into the mass analyzer. So this is a photograph of one of the MALDI targets. And you can see that there's actually several little spots on there. Each of those spots can represent an entirely different sample. This target itself carries 384 different samples on it. Some of the solvent is still present there, but if you let that evaporate for a while, then you'll make a very thin film. Most of what you're seeing is the matrix, but there's a very low concentration of protein embedded within that matrix as well. And what you're seeing here is one of those single spots before and after the laser strikes it. So the laser itself is really focused into a small area, and you can see that it kind of removes most of the material in that process. So here's a MALDI spectrum using these UV chromophores instead. I actually recorded this one myself quite a number of years ago when I was a graduate student, but you can see that, again, it carries a lower charge state than the electrospray did, so we see the singly, doubly, and triply charged as well. The other thing I want to note is that because the matrix is present in such a high concentration, it shows up in our spectrum as well. It has a lower molecular weight, so it shows up down at the low mass region. And what usually happens is the matrix just kind of breaks down and it combines and reacts with other things. So it creates like a whole cluster of different ions at the low mass region. Now, why would you want to use MALDI today instead of like electrospray ionization, for example? Well, there's still several reasons for it. It's still a great technique in terms of its speed, being able to analyze one sample right after the other. It's just a few shots of the laser. But one great thing that you can do with it is a technique known as mass spectrometry imaging. So the idea here is that metal target that I showed you, instead of having discrete samples, you put one big sample across it, or not even necessarily big, one sample, and then you use the laser to kind of move across that single target. The matrix would be just deposited kind of like a spray paint type process, and it coats the entire sample. Now, each and every time we record a spectrum, we have a little pixel of the image that we want. So this is the net effect that you can get. Now, yeah, obviously we're recording thousands of spectra to generate these images, but a spectra is just the time it takes to fire a laser. So you can accumulate these spectra very rapidly. The colors that you see would represent a single M over Z channel. So you can light up the distribution of where a specific molecule will lie onto a surface. What we're looking at here is the brain of a mouse and looking at different compounds, different fatty acids, for example, that are localized across the brain. So yeah, desorptive ionization techniques are extremely popular in mass spectrometry because of techniques that you can do like this with it. And while I didn't cover all of them here, MALDI is definitely one of the more popular ones. So that's all the time that I have. We'll see you around.